You, thank you very much to the organizers and the whole group for this invitation. And what I want to do, it's early, it's morning, I have actually a reading of the question what freedom through some research that I made in the last years, and they are connected just to give an idea with reading of capitalism, the relations between life and death, and what is the status today of agency and subjectivity. One of the central points of my presentation will be also the question of humanity, that I think is key for understanding the whole idea of illegality of freedom. And I will read some things. I will try to have on the PowerPoint just some elements and some things I will talk. So be with me, it's early. And the outcome is that it's actually not a happy end of what I want to say, unfortunately. So it's very kind of questioning what is what freedom, because what freedom stands for. So this is the beginning without my name, but two points of departure. When I got the invitation for this event with such a triggering title, The Illegality of Freedom, freedom was already echoing in my mind for quite some time. Of course, the operation Enduring Freedom. It was there, present for 13 years. The operation Enduring Freedom brought freedom to numerous regions in the world. The operations lasted from October 2001 to December 2014. So freedom was brought in 13 years. And in these 13 years of its active presence, it spilled over many geopolitical spaces and countries, made freedom shaking in Philippines, Horn of Africa, Trans-Sahara, Caribbean, and Central America, and so on. So this is something that I connected immediately with the illegality of freedom. But on the other side, it's also those who can put under question. And one of the authors is Mimi T.A. Nguyen in her seminal book with the title The Gift of Freedom, and with the subtitle War, Debt, and Other Refugee Passages, that she published in 2012, suggests the following. I quote, that the imposition of debt prevents the subjects of freedom from escaping those colonial histories that deemed them unfree. To receive the gift of freedom, then, is to be indebted to empire, perhaps without end. Practically, freedom as operation Enduring Freedom isn't just a rhetorical ploy, as we could think, the title, that sounds pretty and hides the violence of liberal war and empire, but is actually how liberal war and empire conceptualize its violence and power. End of quotation. Such a gift of freedom, she concludes, and I quote again, is contributing to the manufacturing of entire categories of unwanted people, of which the illegal migrant, the undocumented worker, and more the refugee and the asylum seeker are the prototypes. This global regime is characterized by the differential treatment of individuals, groups or communities, with respect to movement or circulation. This differential treatment raises at a deeper level questions about the way in which the quality of being human, and this quality of being human is directly connected to the question of freedom. So, in which the quality of being human as such is instituted in a globalized society, so that some human beings can be hunted by the police of certain states and their freedom of circulation subjected to massive controls and restrictions. So, the gift of freedom is a freedom with an adjective. S, naked freedom. So we see freedom practically, exponentially doubled. It's not going alone. It's not freedom, but it's always a freedom with a certain adjective, a certain part that is given. So it's naked freedom, as one of the works done as films and videos. It's illegal freedom, or it's given as a gift. And this practically stays for an emblematic point in the way how to approach and make the analysis of capitalism. Because of this doubling, of this, the term is not anymore alone. And we will see no citizenship, no freedom, no humanity, nothing stays alone in the time of global capitalism. The relation between labor and capital is also key in understanding the historicity of the notions. And what are these notions with which we work when we talk about illegality of freedom? Sovereignty, citizenship, subject, and humanity. How to deal with the relation of sovereignty on one side and governmentality on the other in the time of neoliberal global capitalism? This will be one of my also main questions, or the second or third question. As the present, class exploitation and racializations, so racist structural discrimination of all levels of production and reproduction of life, to the extent that we can talk of a racialized labor, racialized sexuality, racialized humanity, racialized theory. You have to have this in mind, those who are speaking here, from which point. And also racialized freedom. Freedom that is already divided. Have changed our analysis of life, death, autonomy and subjectivization, not to speak of freedom. Subjectivity is increasingly seen as produced at the intersection of biotechnologies, biomedicine and bioeconomy. A constant work of modulation of the self in relation to desired forms of life. So life is also divided. We have the bios, this very known term that presents actually the lives with forms. Western world has the lives with forms, the bios, that are pushed until the last consequences, more individualism, more being something special, while Zoe, the other term of this life, that is actually the naked life, an animality, Zoe, like animal, is given, though supposedly without a form. So there is no form, only bios has forms. But still, to this Zoe, it's given a power of extra potentialities. The situation is absurd. Though it corresponds to the relation of limitless procedures of neoliberal global capitalism and its multiplication of exploitation, expropriation, and dispossession, that we talk of illegality of freedom is the result also of a crisis, though this is not a crisis provoked by the refugees, but instead the outcome of a management of death, conducted for the sake of the biopolitical sovereignty of the EU nation states. So we have a necropolitical situations regarding the refugees and a biopolitical sovereignty. And what the EU nation states do? They perform actually a necropower procedures. And what are the necropower procedures? Necro is death. They are actually procedures of abandonment, banning, exclusion, and racialization. This is what we have all around. It's all list after list. With this, talking about biopolitical sovereignty on one side and necropower procedures, I open also the differentiation between two terms that I think are key for understanding what's going on. One is biopolitics, the old notion of Foucault, taken by Agamben and so on, and the other is what I think is even more central, necropolitics. First, necropolitics present a new mode of governmentality, for neoliberal global capitalism. Necro means death, politics means a management of death. And practically, necropolitics is a decision over administration of death, is being opposed, as biopolitics, as we know, as a control over life, making life better. If we have such a situation between biopolitics and necropolitics, then we have to ask in which concrete political, economic, and social ideological situation the decision over death, that to manage death, is normalized and accepted. This is the first question. The second, who are those that are selected and targeted as the goal of this necro-sovereign decision, so that they will be only seen as death baggage? The situation of the refugees and the status of their lives and bodies in the camps of European Union, but also when collected as corpses in the Mediterranean Sea, cannot be described solely as murder, as genocide. Surely, these terms have great rhetorical and political value, but they are also connected to certain historical situations that differ from what we have here and now. And if we go back to Mimi Tie Nguyen, in The Gift of Freedom, she makes a direct connection to this quality of being human. And I want to push this thesis, that the answer to the rhetoric question for what stands freedom today, that is absolutely not at all rhetorical, lies precisely within this relation that connects life, death, and the human. And I will go in this direction. Jem Stanescu, in 2013, in his text Beyond Biopolitics, Animal Studies, Factory Farms, and the Advent of Deading Life, it's a pretty new term, Deading Life, states that the human is not a category that exists outside of the political constatations and ontological battles. And I quote, rather, the human is produced and it is the site of great struggles, violence and hierarchy. And the human comes to name the category of beings we seek to protect and foster. And as such, the idea of human exceptionalism can only be understood as related to the concept of biopolitics. But if we take the biopolitics as just a sovereign method for the Western world, we see, making analysis, what's going on in relation to others who are outside of this, that this is not enough. So what is biopolitics? A term in between life and politics, and also can be designated in an axiomatic way. I say biopolitics, the Foucault term, is actually make, live, and let die. And this is what we have today in the European Union, at least for those who are seen the citizens of nation states. But we see a process on the other side of constant dehumanization in the refugee camp, and therefore biopolitics, I argue, is only the politics of life for the Western world, the world that actually protects their nation citizens, as the refugee camp is not a site of humanization, but of dehumanization. It's not enough to make biopolitics therefore the central point of analysis. The point is that this dehumanization brings different ways of thinking about life, death, and freedom. Therefore, we have the term necropolitics, a term in between necro, death, and politics. It was coined in 2003 by Achille Mbembe, who started to discuss in the African context new logic of capital and its processes of geopolitical demarcation of world zones based on the mobilization of the war machine. And from 2001, practically, we have the Operation Enduring Freedom, that is a kind of a way of the engagement of the war machine. He talks about necropolitics in terms saying that necropolitics is connected with the concept of necrocapitalism, and we live in necrocapitalism, though everybody talk about biocapitalism. That is a so necrocapitalism is a contemporary capitalism which organizes its forms of capital accumulation that involve dispossession and the subjugation of life to the power of death. And I want also to be very clear, when I talk about necropolitics, I don't talk about Roberto Esposito thanatopolitic, because thanatopolitics, though thanatos relates to the drive for death, is something else. It's still a Western concept for the Western world. So, to be more precise, we are not talking about thanatopolitics, but about necropolitics. And I'm happy that I'm here. Otherwise, in many of these sessions, will be Roberto Esposito. So, what is actually and how to think necropolitics now? If I said for biopolitics, make live and let die, that means make the good life, welfare system, do everything what you can for the citizens that you think they are citizens and they deserve, and just let die all the others. Necropolitics actually is another story. Means let live and make die. And what this means? Let live if you have funds, if you have families, if you have context, no institutions take care of you. And make die all around. So it's a big, big difference between make live and let live. Let live is a pure abandonment. And more we see this abandonment also in the Western world. Necropolitics, that is always a culmination of the biopolitical, so it's no a cut. They are both sharing the space. If we think about necropolitics as the culmination of the biopolitical, we clearly see the superimposition of the fear of racial impurity. This is why racialization is so present in necro-capitalist global world. Because racial impurity, we see also the way how the refugee camps is managed. Racial impurity is there. It's central. In the light of these arguments, the refugee camps are not simply the state of exception, but a place to see the processes of auto-immunization in order to get rid of those sins as not human. On the other hand, the idea of seclusion is based on racism, as the idea of racial impurity remains central to security at the camp. Those inhuman, again in parentheses, of course, are those presented as natural inhuman. They are already seen not as constructed, but actually bring their inhumanity into the civilized world where they seek for a refugee. They are meticulously constructed as such. First, what comes across as striking is that when biopolitics is framed in a such way, so in relation to necropolitics, we see first the insufficiency of biopolitics as a frame to rethink the refugee camp. Because the refugee camp, it's said in many of the stories, is presented in a public discourse as supposedly to be here to protect and give a protection of human rights. But we clearly see in the last years and before, of course, but less obviously, this is also important, that the camp is a place of dehumanization. Furthermore, it's also connected to a different status of life and consequently death. I want to name the life in the refugee camp not by using the usual rhetoric, but by using a new category, that is, deading life. And deading is coming actually from present participle of death. And I want to stuck to this term. And the term was elaborated by James Stanescu, and he is saying, deading life is a procedure employed to suppress, reduce, diminish, impoverish, ruin life, but is not death. This is quite an important point. The point that Stanescu makes, and which is also present in Foucault, is that the fear of racial impurity remains at the basis of biopower and biopolitics, but is completely out. For almost 30 years, nobody reads the two sentences in Foucault, in which he said, yes, biopolitics for the first world, but racism will be all over and around us. Only recently, it's pulled back. The rise of state racism, so also we can think about a nation state, we can think about a war state, and mostly the European states are all racial state. They actually live from racialization, the EU, but differently depending on the histories. So the rise of state racism produces fears about how races will mix. Therefore, a variety of controls are created precisely in order to regulate populations. What we have at all times are powers' reactions to fears of contamination. And if you think, I wrote this some years in the past already making, and it was like a fairy tale. Everybody would say, what kind of racism? But just I found the 7th of November 2016, a few days ago, in Germany, it was this proposal that started to be present in the news. And actually it was the proposal that refugees has to be immediately caught in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea and immediately shipped back to Africa or any other place. And this practically is simply treating the refugees as a contagious disease. Because when you actually not allowed somebody to take a place, to come and to ask for the asylum, but you immediately shipped, it's really a kind of disease, and it's completely against any kind of laws of human rights. So Stanescu states that if we take seriously Foucault claims that biopolitics about politics taking life itself as its object, then the obvious question arises, what is life? And it's really a buffet of this. And here is the buffet of life. That is quite important because we also see that it's not just division about freedom, life, citizenship, everything will be divided, but inside, not anymore in opposition. And the buffet of buffet is important because the question that is posed is, can we talk about a politicized life or it's just notions? And what are these? What is this buffet? This buffet is Agamben, bare life, Judith Butler, precarious life, Walter Benjamin, mere life, Balibar, disposable life, Ogin Tucker, afterlife, Timothy Campbell, improper life, and Deleuze, a life. In the end, is this proposal. And the proposal is practically deading life. Stanescu also connects this notion of deading life with a changed view on death. He quotes, for example, Primo Levi, who wrote that for Satan victims of the extermination camp, I quote, one hesitates to call their death as death. End of quotation. So, death that we hesitate to call death. Where else is there an engagement with the production and fabrication of corpses? Practically, if we go back to this kind of a buffet, conceptions and buffet of lives, bare life, precarious life, mere life, disposable life, afterlife, improper life, and a life, we see that deading life that can be in the end of this listing is actually some specific condition. Deading life presents a life that isn't left alone, left to die in the language of Foucault, but instead deading life is thoroughly fabricated and artificial. Deading life is not simple death, as it's possible to think when we see the conditions in the refugee camps. And it's not also life that is living but a prosser and a precursor to death. Life is but an added element to an end product, death, but is not actually dying. And this is quite a new relation to the refugee camps, deading life. It's a completely new condition. One of the most important elements also is that deading life, in a certain sense, ask us what kind of use value it has. And I said deading lives present a pure use value. This is a perplexing situation, as everything that is going on in capitalism is connected to exchange value. But what is present in relation to the refugees is a complete veto on the possibility that all these people enter the labor market to become, as all of us from the EU, exchange value. Those who get the job are not coming as refugees, but through what is termed the needs of the diversified labor market, as high-skilled labor force. And if we remember, what was the main demand of the refugee protest camp in Vienna in 2012? That maybe we all forgot that this was going on and it was super important. To work, to become self-sufficient. And while some other demands by the refugees in 2012 and after were negotiated, the entrance into the labor market was out of the discussion. So, with Stanescu I can ask, there has ever been a more complete and tariff realization of the Marx surplus population than such a situation. With this in mind, I will universalize this question and ask, also in relation to Achille Mbembe and Altri, if there has ever been a more complete, superfluous population, as is the case with the refugees in Europe, that are prevented to work and forced to live a life that is not death, but tariffly fabricated use value, a deading life. Colonialism is not only what Edward Said has named a pact between anthropocentrism and Eurocentrism, but furthermore a project of dispossession and dehumanization by capitalism covered by the veil of humanity, that is, as argued by Aimé César, I quote, a sordidly racist concept, end of quotation, or pseudo-humanism. Therefore, if the main characteristics of the biopolitical is pseudo-humanism, because we know that Said is writing in the 70s and is connected with biopolitics, and if it's clear that the human is always a constructed concept against the background of racism and class differentiation, I will state that the machine, the human machine of necropolitics, is the post-human. So biopolitics has the pseudo-human, and necropolitics actually is all centered on the post-human, biotechnology, these bios until the end, but we have the process of dehumanization at the black side of this. Or, if biopolitics resides in colonialism and is pseudo-humanism, I claim that necropolitics resides in coloniality, a new form of colonialism for the time that we live, and it's post-humanism. Both are constructed on a racist foundations, but their rhetoric is different. And what is the rhetoric? For biopolitics still existed a dream. This is how biopolitics pushes us. It dreams. And biopolitics dreams was more human than human. Of course, those coming from like the migrants, the gastarbeiters, they could not match this, more human than human. But necropolitical condition in which we live, it's not about dream, it's about injunction, control, all the time being around, monitored, and actually reframed by many, many demands. And the necropolitical injunction of neoliberal global capitalism is still too human, And when the refugees are coming and say, we are humans like you, the necropolitical system says, still too human. We are not interested anymore in humanity, because the post-human is the one who actually is at the table. So, to put this differently, in necrocapitalism, the human is illegal as such, not only the freedom itself. The necrocapital global capitalism we live in here and now simply despise the humanity of thousands of these abandoned and made obsolete people, the superfluous, those who has no place, who are a pure use value, never being caught in the exchange value, and we are happy to be in the exchange capitalist relation. They claim their subjectivity, but this does not have any meaning anymore in necrocapitalism. Still too human, in the global necropower, capitalism imposed the illegality of freedom. All has to vanish to become illegal, not only freedom, as well the subject as such. This is another consequence of all these processes. Today, the notion of the political subject is seen as a form of an old, archaic subjectivity, and is therefore delegated, really delegated, to the so-called third world capitalism. The consequences are terminal regarding political agency. So, we have a situation of these divisions of all these terms, and also vanishing not only of freedom, or freedom that cannot stand as freedom, but has actually to have this adjective, this form that actually situate it in this passage from biopolitics to necropolitics. So what is maybe one of the next results in all these stories? For example, looking about citizenship. I say that this colonial racial division is applied also to citizenship. As this colonial racial division with class inequalities is applied also to all other terms. And then we have two categories of citizenship. It's not just that you have a citizenship. Be careful. Maybe you are only in one of these categories. That means you can actually step in the other. So the categories of citizenship that are also possible to be seen, and this is just a recent phenomenon, is one is the category which I will name biopolitical citizenship. So, if we are privileged and we are part of the European Union, natural, like this, nation-state citizens, we have a biopolitical citizenship. But then, the other is the necropolitical citizenship, given to refugees and sans-papiers after they die on EU soil. So, racial impurity now doesn't permit them to come. But some years ago, and not so far, in 2013, it was this change. Suddenly, a new kind of citizenship happened, and this was the necropolitical citizenship. At that point, it was October 12th in 2013, that was a big shock for the European Union. Today, people die 400, 500 daily or every day, at least 20. Nobody talks anymore about these things. But at that point, in 2013, 350 refugees from Africa drowned in a single day. And this was kind of an alarm. All the EU started to talk, this is a moment that they have to help, they have to do something. So, a perverse situation happened. It was a big commemoration on the television, but what happened at that moment? That practically, Italy, and with the support of the European Union, decided to give to these 350 people Italian citizenship. This was announced, like I remember very clearly, many of those studying with me, also made a reference, they say, on the television, they said, now they are Italian citizens. Actually, the dream but in the necropolitical injunction, they had to die. And Italian citizenship, why? I said because only giving the possibility to Italian government and the EU to actually bury them in Italy, because this is the law. You cannot bury just people, you know, in the nation state without actually knowing what who they are. And also, cynically, but it's not about cynicism, obviously this was cheaper than sending the dead bodies back, mostly in Africa, to their relatives. The Italian government decided on the other side, and this was a subtext. It was there, but just subtext, to prosecute the few who did survive as they tried to illegally enter Italy and the EU. So they give on one part a necropolitical citizenship to the dead bodies. They finally were Italians. And the other, because the law is saying if you come illegally, they put you in jail, they put these people in jail or in front of the court. This is the clearest sign of the perverse and violent new attitude that Western Europe has toward human rights. After the West, and we have to be very clear, has been for decades heavily capitalizing its democracy on human rights. And practically, the result is the occurrence of a new category of citizenship, necropolitical citizenship. Therefore, as I tried to show, and I'm coming to the end, citizenship today is not only in opposition to non-citizenship, that is the biggest opposition, but is divided inside into two, at least into biopolitical and necropolitical. Similarly, freedom is always coming with an adjective, naked, to give a gift of freedom, illegal freedom, and so on. Therefore, what freedom stands for, I think, for visibly, radically exposed, violent, colonial, racial processes of dehumanization. In the face of neoliberal global capitalist racialization that presents the reproduction of animality, the flesh of those that do not count for humans, because it's talking about the flesh, bodies that are put inside the refugee camps, I claim has to get now a very different frame, because we ask ourselves, where is this agency? And I say, maybe, in relation to other theoreticians, maybe we can start to think differently. It's not about the flesh, but a new category, a political flesh. And this political flesh means something completely different than, for example, the old thinking about the flesh, the chair, for example, in the French theory. Political flesh is precisely the outcome of denied, violent, colonial, racial processes of dehumanization. Therefore, violent, systematic procedure of dehumanization and racialization, class exploitation, that want us to think that any kind of political subjectivity is obsolete, maybe will force us to take the political flesh of the refugees, of those who count nothing for any kind of society, the rest of the world, to be the political agency of the future. And maybe when I asked before, can we think about the politicized life in this necropower capitalism, maybe the political flesh can be this form of politicized life. The political flesh is the one that reveals daily the falsification and travesties of Occidental humanity. Thank you very much.